Your next important message is that once a patient has been diagnosed with a head and neck cancer, that they should see a dentist as part of the multidisciplinary team at least 14 days before they begin their radiation therapy. Just in a nutshell, why is it important at least 14 days before, and what should be happening at that point?
Ideally, if the dentist involved in the multidisciplinary team, they should know at the point of diagnosis, and they should know once the diagnosis is made how that patient's going to be managed. If they're going to have surgery alone, if they're going to have surgery and radiotherapy, if they're going to have all three modalities in terms of surgery, radiotherapy and chemo, or just radiation and chemotherapy. If the dentist can be involved and understand what the treatment plan is, and there is treatment that needs to be done to make that patient dentally fit, ideally it should happen as soon as possible. The reason I say at least 14 days before starting radiotherapy is that if we need to extract teeth, we need at a minimum 14 days to enable that healing to occur before the radiation starts. And I would not like to see dental treatment being the cause of someone's radiation being deferred because they need to have teeth taken out. And the complexity in Australia is that, you know, not everyone sees a dentist every 6 months. The way that our dental system works is that it's essentially privately funded. So many people don't go to the dentist for a long time. And then when they get this diagnosis, they're sort of all caught up in the medical treatments. They don't necessarily realise how important dentistry is. And so I don't like to be the cause to say to someone, well, we need to take, as I've got a patient happening this morning, 10 teeth out, and we have to hold back your radiation to enable the healing to occur before the radiation starts.
Why is it so important that any extractions or major dental needs are met before radiation therapy treatment begins for a head and neck cancer patient? Even though, as we all know, once you get this cancer diagnosis, the system is trying to treat you as quickly as possible. But they do want to clear up any dental problems first, as concisely as you can. Why is that essential?
Because one of the long-term impacts of radiation is that it changes the blood supply, particularly to the lower jaw and particularly to the back area of the lower jaw where your molar teeth are. And that change to that blood supply gets reduced more with time, not less. So it's not a problem that goes away as time passes, it's actually a problem that becomes greater. So the problem after radiation is that the bone changes, and the radiation causes damage as well to the big parotid glands that sit here that produce most of the saliva in your mouth. Now that combination is a little bit of a diabolical combination, because it means that with time, your mouth's drier after radiation, your decay risk increases as a result of the change to the saliva, both the amount and the quality. It means you're more likely to have decay. And if you don't, and if you get decay, it's a slightly different sort of decay. It progresses very rapidly. And then you may need an extraction. And unfortunately, if that extraction is in the area where you've had the radiation, and the bone is affected from the radiation, it means that if I was to do that extraction without preventative measures in place, that bone doesn't have the capacity to heal. So the impact of the radiation to the bone is really only a problem if your dentist needs to take a tooth out. And that happens from about 3 to 6 months after radiation finishes and is a lifelong risk in all areas of your mouth, but the worst and highest risk is in the back area of the lower jaw. So the tissues that the radiation affects during the treatment are the salivary glands, the taste buds, the tissues of the mouth, and people get ulcers and things like that. And so they're the main effects during radiation. And so people get a lot of ulcers during the course of their treatment normally. Their taste goes, the saliva goes, so the ability to eat is compromised. After about 6 or 8 weeks, that slowly starts to improve, and their taste comes back and the tissues of their mouth come back. But the ongoing impacts of the radiation to the saliva are lifelong. They get better, they do improve, and certainly the newer techniques that the radiation oncologists are using to avoid that big parotid salivary gland, to de-escalate the treatments in terms of the human papillomavirus cancers, have made a big difference in the quality of people's saliva and the quantity afterwards. But the problem is there still are significant changes to both those things, quality and quantity. And if you don't have good quality and quantity of saliva in your mouth, the health of your mouth, not only the teeth but also the tissues is compromised. Your risks around the different bacteria growing, the bacteria that can cause periodontal disease and decay increase. Risks around oral thrush in your mouth increase. And it's that ongoing increased risk of decay that becomes the biggest issue for us as dentists to manage. So we will, one of the things I do is I do a saliva analysis for my patients at 3 months, 6 months and 12 months. And that guides the preventive program that I then recommend to my patients. I put them on a closer review schedule so they come and see me every 3 months in that 12-month period post-radiation rather than a six-monthly checkup, and then give that information back to their dentist to say, you know, this patient's got ongoing problems with saliva, you need to see them every 4 months. I explain to the patient why ongoing dental care is important to avoid those decay risks and extraction risks and the problem with their jawbone, etc. But for me, if I know a patient has got a human papillomavirus head and neck cancer, if I know that they don't have a heavy smoking or alcohol history, I know the prognosis of the patient is going to be very good. And then I know that I don't need to be, I need to spend a lot of time with that patient, educating them around understanding to maintain their oral health. I need to be careful about the teeth I keep behind and don't take out. And I don't want people to think that, you know, dentists are jumping in there and extracting a lot of teeth. We certainly are not. But if I know a patient's got a human papillomavirus cancer and they are likely to live 10, 15, 20 years because the response of the medical treatments will be so good, I have to look at those teeth and think, I need to, and their dentist needs to keep those teeth healthy for 20 years because their radiation dose has been the same. So that changes my treatment planning, my thinking, how I educate the patient, etc.